Hey guys, I am Venkat and this is part 22 of Web Development with Blazor video series. In this video, we'll discuss data validation in ASP.NET Core Blazor. There are two ways to validate data in a Blazor data grid: by using validation rules property of grid column component and by using validation attributes in system.componentModel.dataAnnotations namespace. At the moment, in this data grid, we don't have any validations, which means we can wipe out first and last name and then click update. Notice both the columns are blank, and this is true even in the underlying employees database table. Now, let's enforce a couple of validation rules on this first name grid column, and let's do that using validation rules property. Notice on the grid column, we have validation rules, and when I hover the mouse over, we can see it is expecting an object of type validation rules. So let's create a new object of type validation rules. And from the IntelliSense, we can see all the different types of validations that are supported: email, max, max length, min length, etc. Now, let's use required validation. And again, from the IntelliSense, we can see this property expects a value of type Boolean, whether we want required validation or not. We want required validation, so let's set it to true. And let's also enforce min length validation. Again, from the IntelliSense, you can see this is expecting a value of type integer, basically the minimum number of characters that we want in the first name column. Now, when we put this row in edit mode and then provide only one character for first name, notice we have min length validation in effect. Please enter at least two characters. And if I don't enter any characters at all and then tab out, we have required validation. So we need to provide a value for first name. Let's also provide a value for last name and then click update. Validation rules are triggered when an input element loses focus, like our first name field, or when the form itself is submitted. At the moment, on this last name field, we don't have required validation. This means I can empty the field and then submit this form by clicking the update button. Now, let's enforce both these validation rules, required and min length, even on the last name field. In the interest of time, let's actually copy this validation rules property and place it on the last name field. In the first name field, we already have a value. This means when we change this value, let me actually wipe it out. And then when the element loses focus, the required validation is triggered immediately upon the first name field losing focus. In the case of last name field, we didn't have any value here already. And I'm not changing this field in any way. I'm simply making this element lose focus by pressing the tab key. And notice we don't have the required validation error triggered. Okay, so the key point to keep in mind is validation rules are triggered when an element loses focus. That is, when we change the value in a field, and then when the element loses focus, that's when the validation rules are triggered. If we don't change the values of the elements, then the validation rules are not triggered. For the validation rules to be triggered, we have to submit this form. So notice what's going to happen when I submit this form by clicking this update button. That's when the required validation on the last name field is triggered. So the key point to keep in mind is validation rules are triggered when an input element loses focus or when the form is submitted. At the moment, to enforce validation rules on this data grid, we are using validation rules property. Now, the downside of this approach is if we have another instance of this data grid, either in this page or in another Razor page, we have to repeat all these validation rules. Let me actually show this in action. Let's make a copy of this data grid and paste it on the same page. And then let's remove these validation rules from this first name field and last name field. On this first data grid, we don't have any validation rules. We only have them on the second data grid. This means I can use this grid to effectively empty first and last name and then still submit the form. There we go. So the key point to keep in mind is validation rules property enforces validation only on that specific instance of the data grid. If you have another data grid, you need to repeat all the validation rules even on that data grid. A better and centralized way to enforce these validation rules is by decorating model class properties, in our case, employee class properties, with validation attributes in system.componentModel.dataAnnotations namespace. This is called model validation. Now, we're going to use model validation. So on the second data grid, let's remove validation rules property, both from the first name field and the last name field. Data source for this data grid is this employees property. And from the IntelliSense, you can see this property data type is list of employee. So the model class for the data grid is employee class, which is present in the shared project. So let's open this file. We want to enforce required validation on this first name property. So we simply decorate it with required attribute. This attribute is present in system.componentModel.dataAnnotations namespace. So let's bring that in. Let's also enforce min length validation. For that, we use min length attribute. And with min length attribute, we need to specify the minimum number of characters we want. In our case, we want 2. Now, if we try to submit this form without providing a value for first name, we get validation error as expected. And even on the second instance of the data grid, notice validation works exactly the same way. At the moment, on this email address field, we don't have any validation. Even if I simply type the name of the employee as email address and then try to submit a page, notice we don't have a validation error. Let's enforce email address validation. Same idea, decorate email property with email address attribute. Notice now, if we provide an invalid email address, we get the validation error. .NET provides several built-in validation attributes. For example, required attribute, which specifies the field is required. Range specifies the minimum and maximum value allowed. Min length specifies the minimum length of a string. Max length, maximum length of a string. Compare compares two properties of a model. For example, compare email and confirm email properties. Similarly, password and confirm password. Regular expression validates if the provided value matches the pattern specified by the regular expression. In addition to validation attributes, .NET also provides these general purpose attributes. Display format sets the display format for a data grid column. Display sets the display name for a data grid column. Editable indicates whether a field in the data grid is editable. Key specifies the primary key column in a data grid. At the moment, in the date of birth column, we are displaying both date and time part. Let's say we only want to display the date part. And there are two ways to achieve that. If we want to do it at the data grid level, we can use the format property for that and set the format to a small letter d, basically short date, which only displays the date part. And the other way is to set the display format attribute on date of birth property in the employee class. We specify data format string. And again, we set it to a small letter d. We can also apply this format string in edit mode, that is, when the row is in edit mode. And for that, we use this property, apply format in edit mode, true or false. Now, the column header text is date of birth. And at the moment, this header text is coming from header text property on the respective grid column. Now, we can also control it using display name attribute. Let's actually do that. Let's remove the header text property from the grid column and instead on this respective property in the employee model class, let's use display name attribute and set the display name you want. We can also control if this property is editable by using editable attribute. Another way to do this, if you want to do it at the data grid level, is by using allow editing property on the respective grid column. Let's actually do it using editable attribute. We don't want it to be editable, so let's set the value to false. Now, in the date of birth column, we only have the date part, no time part. And when we put the row in edit mode, this column is not editable. But then if we take a look at the header text, it is the column name, date of birth. It's not taking the display name that we have specified right here. That's because we should actually be using display attribute and then set the name property. Notice now the header text is DOB as expected in the second grid. But in the first grid, we still have date of birth. Why is that? Well, that's because on the first grid, we have explicitly specified the header text using header text property. At the moment, notice the default min length validation error message that we have. the field first name must be a string or array type with a minimum length of 2. Personally, I don't like this message. It's very long and a bit cryptic to the end user. I want something simple. Maybe first name must contain at least 2 characters. On all these built-in validation attributes, required min length, email address, etc., we have error message property, which we can use to override the built-in validation error message. Notice, now we see our simple overridden validation error message. At the moment, we already have validation on this email field. If we supply an invalid email address, we get the validation error as expected. Now, here is our new business requirement. Let's say we only want to allow presumetech.com as the email domain. If the user supplies any other email domain, for example, gmail.com, we want to display a validation error. Email domain must be presumetech.com. We'll discuss how to implement this using custom validation attribute in our next video. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.